Now, shall we turn to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, verse 35? Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, verse 35, I am reading. But in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. Our living and loving Savior, bless the reading and meditation of his precious word unto us. Shall we look unto him? Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank thee for thy word which is eternally settled in heaven. O Lord, request thee as we have gathered in thy presence with great expectations to hear thy voice and thy word. Lord, speak to us, release thy word unto us. Satisfy our hearts by the fatness of thy house. Thank thee for all those who are praying for us all over the world. Answer all our prayers beyond our asking or even thinking. Let thy grace triumph over all human frailty. Committing our doubts into the loving hand, pray with thanksgiving in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Now, last time, I think fourth of this month, we were considering this verse. In every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. There are three fragments here. One is, we are to be accepted by him. And there are two conditions for his acceptance we have seen last time. That is, the one is fearing God, fear of the Lord. And then second one is show forth works of righteousness. Before going to anything else, let us get into the subject straight away to save time. The first thing is fearing God, the way the word of God tells us to do so. Many times, as I said last time, very loosely this word is used, not understanding the significance of that word. We have read that verse in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13. The writer says, conclusion of the whole matter after showing so many wonderful things in that book, Ecclesiastes, he says, the conclusion of the whole matter is, fear God and keep the commandments of the Lord. Fear God and keep the commandments of the Lord. These are the two things he says. There are so many things said, but out of all, two things are very essential. Imperatives, musts, that is, fear God. We have seen some of the things concerning fearing God. It means tremble at his word, tremble at his presence. And when you fear God, you will be a different person. You will fear no man. Concerning Job, we have seen, he feared God and he eschewed evil. Job chapter 1, verse 1, and also Job chapter 1, verse 8, we have read. That means, if you fear God, you will hate evil. If you fear God, you will run away from every form of evil. If you fear God, you will run away from every form of unrighteousness. If you fear God, you will run away from every worldliness. If you fear God, you will live a life of separation unto God. That is why Job was called a just person. Just person means a righteous person. Now, secondly, we have seen how Abraham did not hesitate to sacrifice his only son, Isaac. Then the commendation came, as we have read in Genesis chapter 22, verse 12. Now I know that thou fearest God. Now I know that thou fearest God. When Abraham was prepared to sacrifice that which was very close to his heart, Isaac was very close to his heart, because God himself said, it is through Isaac you will be blessed, not through Ishmael. And that very God, he says, sacrifice Isaac. He did not question God. He did not have any doubt whatsoever. Whatever Lord may ask me to do, I will do it. But ultimately, he will accomplish his promise. That is what the faith of Abraham talks about. He had a very strong faith, we read in Romans chapter 4, verse 20. Strong faith is when he placed Isaac on the altar to sacrifice. I was saying on the other day, when Abraham was taking Isaac with the firewood on his head, and fire as they were walking down to that place, Moriah, Isaac asks him, "Behold the fire and the wood, where is the lamb?" Because Isaac had always seen whenever Abraham, his father, offered an sacrifice on the altar, there was fire, there was wood, and there was a lamb. But the lamb is missing. So that is why, very naturally, this lad, young fellow, asked, "Behold the fire and the wood, where is the lamb?" Abraham knew that it was Isaac who is going to be offered. Now, in that context, in my meditation Bible, I wrote, who is that father whose heart will not melt when his own son is asking him like this? But Abraham was not moved because he had such faith, strong faith. When you fear him, you will have that faith, total trust. Take my words, total trust. We do not know how God will help me, but he will do it. That is what his faith talks about. See Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. 17, 18, and 19. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Now verse 19, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure, in type. He received him from the death situation when he kept him on the altar and took the knife. By faith he had already offered him. Then came the commendation. Now I know that thou fearest God. So do not use this word fearing God so loosely. We need to know the significance. If you fear God, you will be a person who hates evil, who will run away from every form of evil. If you fear God, you are prepared to sacrifice anything for the cause of Christ. You are prepared to sacrifice as Paul had sacrificed, as Stephen had sacrificed his own life, as all the apostles of old put themselves on the altars, as they were torn asunder, as their lives were at stake, still they proclaimed the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is where that fear of God comes. If you have got fear of God, you will have faith, total trust on him. So if you fear God, you will have the fear that Abraham feared. So the question is, do you fear God as Job feared God? Do you fear God as Abraham feared God? Now you see some of those again concerning Joseph. It is written in Genesis chapter 42, verse 18. Do this and live, for I fear God, he says. His brethren have come, the tormentors have come to him. By this time, he has become the ruler over Egypt. Everything was in his hand. He was 2IC, second in charge. Next to the king, he was the authority. And they have come for grains. And these people who troubled him, bet him, put him in a pit where there was no water and sold him out. They hated him. They could not even see eye to eye. Whereas Joseph loved them, that we are not seeing. But Joseph had this heavenly love, divine love for these people. That is why he says, do this and live, for I fear God. That would mean, if you fear God, you will have love for those who hate you. You will have love for those who criticize you. You will have love for those who create problems for you. You will love those who develop slanders against you. Many times you come across such situations. People develop slanders against you and talk ill of you, make a wrong propaganda against you. But still, we should pray for them with a lot of love and concern. We should be merciful unto God, because Lord is merciful. My God is graceful and merciful, with full of love. So also, I bestow that love. So if you fear God, you will have that quality of loving your own enemies, those who hate you, those who trouble you. In the offices, you will find many times people without no cause, they will try to pull your leg, create problems for you. Many times you notice it. I have seen in my own office work. Many times create problems for you unnecessarily, without any cause, because they cannot tolerate. They cannot see your progress, your development in your career. They will try to trouble you. But as a child of God, as the chosen of God, the called of God, you should love them more than anybody else. That is the divine quality. So if you fear God, you will have love. Now, fourthly, you look at those midwives in Exodus chapter 1, verse 17. The king has commanded that all the firstborn male child should be killed. But they did not do that. You know, the Exodus chapter 1, verse 17. There we read, but the midwives feared God and did not as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the men, children alive. It needs guts. They risked their life. They did not care for what king would do. King had got the authority to kill them because he was a cruel king. But yet, the word of God says the midwife feared God. When you fear God, you will have no fear of anybody else in this world. You will not bow down as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did, as Daniel of old lived his prayerful life. So you will have no fear what man can do when the Lord is on our side. Let them do anything, but yet I will not do it. That is the spiritual, scriptural attitude one must develop as you grow in the grace of the Lord. It is then it can be said that you really fear God. From where can we learn this fearing God? See, book of Psalm 34. Psalm 34, verse 11. Come ye children, hearken unto me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. How nicely David says this. Come ye children, hearken unto me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. So it is the Lord who teaches us as we hear the word of God from the different messengers of God, not merely appreciating, but we should be the doers of the word of God. We should understand what exactly Lord is telling us as we hear the word of God. As you sit in the presence of the Lord, you should have a prayer emanating from the bottom of your heart saying, Lord, speak to me. Oh Lord, here am I. I have come to thy presence. You speak to me. You instruct me. You correct me. You reprimand me. You convince me and convict me of my nature. Then Lord will speak to you if you have got open mind totally. If you are a stiff-necked, hard-hearted, thick-skinned person, however much the word of God is given, nothing happens. You know, there is that means you have the bulletproof, you know, jackets, the people who are in danger in life, the gen category people are given bulletproof jackets. Now, in the church, many people come with word-proof jackets. Word-proof jackets. Nothing, their heart is totally shut. Nothing will go inside. Many years ago, I was in Kalimpong convocation. Brother Philip asked me to teach a song which I composed. Kahe Teri Gawai, what is thy testimony? What is your life? That was a challenging song. As I was teaching them in Hindi, one brother got up from the congregation, came in front of the dais in the pulpit, and he clicked a photograph. But I noticed the aperture, the lid is not open. The lid is, aperture is closed. Aperture cap is still on. He never knew. He thought he captured my picture. And then I was singing the last stanza of that song. Again, same brother comes in front. Again, he clicks. Still, the aperture was closed. He thinks he has captured me, but there is no photograph inside because the aperture was closed. Then I realized how many of us come with totally shut hearts. Hearts are shut. Let anybody give any element of message. Nothing happens. As you come, so you go. That's why there is no development. there is no spiritual growth, there is no spiritual advancement in your life. Years may pass, you are there only where you are. You are no use in the house of God. As you listen to the word of God, you learn things. We have learned right from 1953, as I was born again, when I come to the house of God, we used to learn in Gudur, the native place, my native place, which is 80 miles from Madras. We have worship service from 9 o'clock to 5 o'clock. Full message for worship, full message for table, full message for the last message, and full time for worship. Everyone in the assembly will worship the Lord. So that is how I was groomed. And I was a very ardent listener of the word of God. That's why I think God has blessed me. Listen to the word of God very carefully. There is something for you. It is not by accident you are here in the presence of the Lord. It is by a divine appointment God has kept you here, seated in your own homes, comfortably, in sofas or what chairs or whatever it is. But it is a wonderful time to listen to the word of God and be convicted wherever things are going wrong. When you are not able to love others, when you are not able to fear him as you ought to fear, when you are convinced and convicted, let there be a prayer in your heart right from that time. Oh Lord, forgive me, cleanse me, wash me. I don't have the fear that the word of God talking about. People may tell again concerning me that I fear God, but I know, Lord, in the light of thy word, I have no fear of God. So confess it. That is how he will grow in the grace of the Lord. When the word of God is given, we are cleansed by the word of God. If you obey to the word of God, that is what the word of God says in John's Gospel, chapter 15, verse 3. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you, the Lord says. Very important words. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. You don't have to wait until the last message, where some messengers may give altar call for confession. No, as the word comes to you, as you are convicted, then and there, while you are seated in the presence of the Lord, in the midst of the congregation or at home, cry unto the Lord, Lord, forgive me, cleanse me, wash me. That is why I say, house of God, or wherever we are gathering together, it is a servicing station where you are serviced spiritually, and you are washed and cleansed. And by the time the service is over, you are thoroughly changed, thoroughly transformed, where you have recommitted yourself into the hands of God. So that is how you have to commit yourself unto the Lord. Listen to the word carefully and apply it to our lives and retain the word of God and then practice it. You know, that is what the word of God says, James chapter 1. James chapter 1, verse 21. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. Which is able to save your souls. Then verse 22. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. How many times we content ourselves that we have heard the word of God? Verse 23 says, for if he any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. Nothing happened to them. As that man camera is covered with the lid, so also we close our hearts and come and sit. As you come, so also you go. Open up your heart. Lord, help me to be receptive to thy word. Do not develop immunity to the word of God. Don't come with word-proof jackets to the house of God. Come with open mind. Lord, speak to me. I am a weak person. Though my spirit is willing, my flesh is weak. And when you are sincerely come, Lord will speak to us, because we need to be conscious of these end times. We are in the end times. At any time, the Lord can come. Any time. We do not know when he would come. Suddenly, all of a sudden, he would come. At the time, we should be found faithful in the sight of God. as I told you last time, on the COVID, there are so much of counseling, advice, and alerts are being given among relatives and friends. So many emails and SMSs they go here and there. But concerning the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, nothing is happening. This man is not moved. This man is unmoved concerning the second advent of the Lord Jesus Christ. At any time he can come. Let us be alert. Long time ago, I read some portion, a testimony of a carpenter in a decision magazine of Billy Graham. There was a decision magazine who used to come. In that, there was a carpenter who was born again. He was going to such a church where there was a richness of the word of God. Everybody was talking about the alertness of believer because the Lord is coming at any time. So he was told Lord can come at any time. So this carpenter, as he was working in his shed, working on the wood, very often he would go with the tools in his hand to the open place and look at the sky whether he would come. So much, he was so conscious. As you get a telegram or some message that somebody is arriving after a long time from other station, it is as real as that. When somebody is coming, what he will do? He will prepare for himself and we will do lots of things to get ready to receive him. And if any vehicle comes, somebody will go and run to the gate and see whether he had come. But the vehicle has passed. So there was a curiosity. There is inquisitiveness that is lamentably missing in the lives of the believers of today concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. May God help us to be alert by the minister of the word of God, who may be enthused, encouraged to wait for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ with great expectation. My Lord would come again. If that is your real feeling, then you will prepare yourself at every time. As I told you last time, whenever I go to bed, I prepare myself. Many people have slept and slept and slept and gone. We do not know what would happen next day, whether I will see the light of the day. So I prepare myself, Lord, prepare me. Here am I, wash me, cleanse me. So there should be preparedness, committing ourselves totally, surrendering ourselves totally at the feet of the Lord. Then God's name would be glorified. Then there was Nehemiah. Concerning Nehemiah, there is a wonderful testimony shared in Nehemiah chapter 5, verse 15. He lived a life of separation. He testified that all his predecessors have been doing a lot of wrong things, but he said, I don't do those things because I fear God. That is a wonderful testimony. But the former governors that had been before me were chargeable unto the people and had taken of them bread and wine beside 40 shekels of silver. Yea, even their servants bear rule over the people. But, note that word, but so did not I because of the fear of God. See, the fear of God will not enable you to do what your predecessors have been doing. Other people, worldly people are doing. Unregenerated people are doing. In the offices where we are working in the midst of unregenerated people. They resort to so many worldly methods to do so many things. A child of God will not do that at any cost. He will maintain sincerity and truthfulness as Lord is seeing him. He is always conscious that my Lord is seeing me. My Lord is hearing me. If you are conscious of that, you will never commit a mistake. Nehemiah was very pure. That is why he had so much of burning desire for the house of God. He wept when he saw the gates were burning and the walls of Jerusalem have fallen down. He was so sad. That was visible. The king could ask, what has happened to you? That sadness is missing these days, as you see in the church. As you see the worldliness in the church, that is not moving you at all. Are you concerned about what is happening in the church? There was a time in the 16th century itself, one servant of God said, when I look for the world, I find it in the church. when I look for the church, I find it in the world. Now there is no difference. There is so much of mix up. It is very difficult to identify a true believer, true follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to live a life of separation. That separation should be visible, should be seen. Now see, one more thing we will see and then switch on to other subject. See, Exodus chapter 18. Exodus chapter 18, verse 21. Exodus 18, 21 says like this. Moreover, thou shalt provide out of all the people able men. Note that word, able men, such as fear God. Note that also. Men of truth, hating covetousness, and place such over them to be rulers of thousands, and rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties, rulers of tens. This is the wonderful counsel, rather divine counsel of Moses' father-in-law, Jethro, and which was approved by God. Afterwards, we understand, he says, call those people. God has approved what Jethro had said, and that was followed. What type of people God wants? Able men, such as fear God. See, the Spirit of God kept that fragment. Men of truth, hating covetousness, place such, that is the quality of a deacon and an elder, or the responsible brethren, where those who lead the fellowship. Verse 25, same chapter, verse 25, Exodus chapter 18, verse 25, and Moses chose able men out of all Israel and made them heads over the people, rulers of thousands, rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties, rulers of tens. And that was the pattern that God allowed to be in the congregation of Israel. So same thing is said in Timothy, Titus, what are the qualifications of the elders and deacons. So right from the beginning, even in the Old Testament, such principles were already notified because he knows the end from the beginning. So if you fear God, you will be an able person who fears God. That is very important. So the fear of God, we are seeing from various ways, very, very important. Inculcate this fear of God in the lives of your children, in the lives of the other, your friends and relatives and the fellow believers. You be an example how you maintain this fear of God. This would be visible. This would be seen by your various activities in the church, the way you live, the way you conduct yourself. Then you will be a role model in the church. That is how every person should be. Now, secondly, very importantly, I would like to read that verse again. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, verse 35. But in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. But in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. The word righteousness is a very important word, is much used in Romans. Romans is a wonderful, great tract, gospel tract, we can say, among all the letters or the scripture, Romans. You will find every chapter deals with that righteousness. We need to be righteous. Somebody said concerning another senior servant of God, brother, he had got the word, but he is not righteous. There could be a word, there could be a person who will be giving much word because some people give, as the lecturers in the school and college, as they read the book, and then it is academic, I call academic preachers. They read Bible, and then they preach. Out of the text, they preach without practicing. He should practice the word of God. See, book of Ezra, chapter 7. Book of Ezra, chapter 7, verse 10. For Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord. Note that Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord and to do it, and to teach in Israel statues and judgments. See, there is a divine order mentioned here. This order cannot be changed. This order cannot be reversed in any way. This order has to be followed very strictly, seeking the law of the Lord, seeking the word of God, and do it. That means practice it, and then teach Israel statutes and judgments. So we need to meditate the word of God, and whatever way God has spoken to you through that meditation, you practice it, you be prepared to practice it, then you preach that word. Then there is power in the word of God. So we ought to be righteous in order to pray unto the Lord. Righteousness is such an important subject. We take it very easily. We have fasting prayers, whole night prayers, half night prayers. I keep hearing half night prayers, whole night prayers, fasting prayers. One person in Madras, he told me, he prayed for, he declared fasting prayer for 30 hours continuously. 30 hours for some money. He declared, we need so much of money for the church. Let us pray for 30 hours. That is not an act of faith. So however much you may fast and pray, however much you may pray and cry unto the Lord, those cries will not reach heaven, because what the word of God says is, in Psalm 34, verse 15, his eyes are open unto the righteous, and see, the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are upon, open unto their cry. Note that again I am reading. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto the cries of the righteous. You need to be righteous to cry unto him. You should come unto the ground of righteousness, where you show forth works of righteousness through your life. It is on that ground when you cry, Lord will hear. Otherwise, however much you may cry, Lord will not hear. Psalm 34, verse 17. Psalm 34, verse 17 says like this. These are the words which are very important. The righteous cry, note that word. The righteous cry, and the Lord heareth and delivereth them out of all their trouble. Very important thing is the righteous cry. You need to be a righteous person to pray to the Lord. You need to be a righteous person to worship the Lord. You need to be a righteous person to preach the word of God. You need to be a righteous person in the fellowship who can bring edification in the body of Christ. See, 2 Timothy chapter 3, there we find the importance of righteousness. 2 Timothy chapter 3. There we find chapter 16 first, 16 and then 17. 2 Timothy, chapter 3, verse 16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That is the importance of righteousness. That man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto good works. That means the works of righteousness. So the preaching of the word of God is meant to make people more and more righteous. More and more, I mean, grow in the grace of the Lord. As you grow more and more righteous from one class to another class. One level to another level. That means it is progressive. This side of heaven, there is no perfection. We make a progress. We continue to make a progress as you obey him. Because Lord's promise is for us in Philippians chapter 1 verse 6. The one who has begun his work in our heart, he will continue to do it until the day of Jesus Christ. Being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. That means as you obey him, as you take the word of God, and being convicted, as you perform the word of God, then you are prepared, and you are prepared for good works through your life. So you have to be very, very careful when he talks about righteousness. See, first Peter chapter 2. First Peter chapter 2, verse 24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed. Being dead unto sin, should live unto righteousness. We should live unto righteousness. See, if you want to see more, see Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, verse 17. Romans chapter 6, verse 17. But God be thanked that you are servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Now verse 18. Being then made free from sin, ye become the servants of righteousness. We are the servants of righteousness. Earlier we were servants of sin, because God of this world, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, blinded our hearts, blinded our eyes. We were blindfolded by God of this world. That's why we were groping in darkness. We do not know what we were doing. Sin after sin we have been committing, multiplying our sinful life. But there was a time when God opened our hearts. According to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, the glory of God shined in our hearts. Then we could see things in the right perspective. Then we cried unto the Lord for the forgiveness of sins. That should happen every day, because we are still living in this corruptible body, living in this corruptible world. That is why sinful dust keep falling on us, sometimes with knowledge, sometimes unawares. That is why we read that verse again and again whenever you come around the table of the Lord. 1 Corinthians 11:28, let a man examine himself, so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. We need to examine ourselves whether we are righteous. Many times when you see certain things, we are not righteous. We have to confess. I know certain situations, I'll quote, you may understand what I mean. There was a man, a senior brother, who was given some advance from the church for love feast. Say 10,000 rupees he was given to purchase various items for the love feast of the church. Then after the event was over, when the brethren who were managing finance asked him, he's a senior brother, brother, give the account. You know, 10,000 has been spent, write your voucher. Right? You have purchased it, you give account, you give vouchers, receipts, and then give proper account. So he thinks he is a big man, so he doesn't have to give. He's not righteous. Another way, somewhere I heard that construction was given, somebody was made responsible for the construction. Few lakhs were made available to him. Then after the construction was over, before the dedication of the place, and the brethren who were in charge of the money asked him to submit all the vouchers so that they could account for the audit. Then he said, you have given 3 lakhs. 3 lakhs have been spent, right? You yourself right. He is not a righteous person. Think about it. There are so many things like this happen. If we read Ezra chapter 8, there is a wonderful example. As Cyrus declared that the walls of Jericho should be built and the gates should be re-erected, then God stirred up the heart of Cyrus and given a lot of gold and so many vessels to be carried. And they were measured and given. You read Ezra chapter 8, you will have a wonderful account. Everything was weighed and given to them. And then they were supposed to go there and then again weigh and hand over to the people concerned, the Levites. There is a definite pattern. That is why Brother Baxing has introduced, at the time of the counting of the cash, of the offerings, more than one, two brethren will count the cash. There was an assembly in Maharashtra. One brother, after the counting, one of the responsible brethren take the box to his house. He has got the key of that box. And after some time, another brother, who is a friend of him, he is also a senior brother, he goes to their house for Tuesday prayer meeting. At that time, they will count it. Does it make any sense? Is there any sanctity in that activity? And then it was also revealed I and Brother Philip and Brother John Floyd, we went there to solve their problem. There it was revealed that these people will not deposit the entire money. They will take off some money for themselves and only partly they will deposit. It was revealed and they were asked to step down. How can you be righteous? Small things, you think, you take things for granted. You have to be very meticulous because we have to do with consuming fire. Read that verse in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 29. See, 28 and 29 we shall read. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Then the very immediate line says, for our God is a consuming fire. Remember, we ought to do with the consuming fire. We ought to do with God of purity, God of holiness. Nothing is hidden from Him. He knows your thinking, your strategy, your motive in following and serving Him. What is your motive? That is where we have to be very, very clear. With the fear of the Lord, do the work of the Lord. Then God's name would be glorified. So you should be righteous to serve Him. Are you righteous? This is a pertinent question is being asked by the Spirit of God. Are you righteous? You are coming to the house of God, doing various errands. You are doing a lot of sacrifices, your time, your money, your so many things. But the question remains, are you righteous in the sight of God? First step is you should fear God and then show forth works of righteousness. Concerning Noah, it was said in Genesis chapter 7, verse 1. Genesis chapter 7, verse 1. And the Lord said unto Noah, come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. Lord has seen, Lord attests a commendation, Lord certifies that Noah was a righteous person. So what is the quality of a righteous person? You find it in Noah's life itself. There's a wonderful verse in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. In the list of the heroes of faith, that verse stands out in the midst of all the verses because the verse begins with the word by faith and it is concludes by faith. It is prefixed by faith and suffixed by faith. And in between, there are seven lessons of faith for us. We are not going to see all that, but remember the type of man he was. What do we read there in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7? By faith, being warned of God, of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became heir of righteousness. That is the quality of man who is righteous. And he became the heir of righteousness because the wonderful quality of person is there, full of righteous qualities. He was moved with fear. The word of God came from heaven, as we read in the Genesis chapter 6. He found grace in the sight of God, and God revealed his heart unto him. I will destroy the world. And then he instructed him what he should do. And then he gave a wonderful plan for the ark. And then he obeyed according to Genesis chapter 6, verse 22. He did as Lord has commanded him. So did he, we find there. Then in the next verse, we find 7 verse 1, he found in the sight of God righteous man and his family was preserved. There we find in that Hebrews chapter 11 verse 7, I am now concluding, he was moved with fear and prepared an ark for the saving of his house. Apart from various considerations, he was very much burdened for the family. He was very much burdened for the family. In the midst of all his busyness, he was conscious of the family. That is why he labored in preparing an ark. Concerning Joshua also, it was said in Joshua chapter 24, verse 15, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. He was a great warrior. He fought many battles. We find that in Joshua chapter 10. So many battles he fought. In the midst of all that, he was conscious in the back of his mind concerning his family. That is why he could challenge the children of Israel after bringing to their notice the goodness of God and the grace of God. Then he said, whatever is your option, that is left to you. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That is the quality of a righteous man. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7, we see concerning Noah as a righteous person. That is why he was burdened for his family. It is not enough that he should be saved. He wanted that his family also should be brought into that preservation. So God made us in the image of God. When we were saved, when our sins are forgiven, that old man, that means the image of God that we found in the Garden of Eden, was edged out by God himself by forgiving all of our sins. That is the time, that is the juncture in our life that we were in the image of God. But slowly and steadily, the sinful dust keep on falling on us. As we come to him, he will clear the dust, and again we go into the world. Again we become worldly. It is finally, we find in 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, when you see him as he is, we will be like him. We shall be like him because we see him as he is. So God prepares us for that great event in our life. Beloved, now are we the sons of God? It does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Until that time, he is molding us, bending us, preparing us for that great event. There was a sculptor who was working with his tools on a big rock, black rock. There is nothing there, but apart from that rock, there are a lot of already the sculptures he has already made, brought out wonderful figures. They are all there surrounding. One person comes and asks him, hey, how could you make all these beautiful things out of this dead rock? Then he said, no, this is not dead rock. I see in this rock the same figure. I see the same figure in this rock. I am only clearing out the waste that is surrounding the figure. Try to get this properly. That figure is already there in this rock. I see it. I am only removing the waste that is covering that beauty of that figure. That is what Lord is doing in our lives. He is clearing out waste that is covering this image of Christ. By faith, as you trust him, as you depend upon him, as you give yourself into his everlasting arms, as you fear him, as you show forth works of righteousness, all that waste that is covering us will be removed. That is the final of our life. When the Lord would come again, when we see him as he is, we shall be like him. That is the beauty of this heavenly sculptor who is working on us. A wonderful thought. Think of this. Meditate more and more. God will reveal much more. It is still inconclusive. God himself will help us to know. Let us read that verse and conclude. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, verse 35. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, verse 35. But in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. May God help us that we may be accepted of him, having these qualities of fearing God and showing forth works of righteousness. May God bless this word unto us.